there's probably not the evidence, you know, certainly there's not the evidence, but, you know, just being in those locations and hearing those stories, you know, kind of, you know, brings, you know, at least a tactile connection to the cases. But, no, that's a good case. But, you know, we sort of, you know, it's a question. You know, we still don't know the answer. Like, what was it? You know, was it extraterrestrials? Which is certainly a possibility, right? But you know, there's probably a lot of other different explanations as well. And yeah, it's yeah, that's a great case. And I would love to learn more about that and see if there was any evidence that was able to be you know, gathered from that. Because, you know, that's how we get closer to the answers. Some of these cases, certainly, we will not get any definitive answers, and there'll always be that mystery aspect as to what it was, and then we kind of fill in, you know, the what-ifs. Yeah, maybe those two locations aren't connected. You know, maybe they were different events. That's possible. It's also possible that, yeah, maybe a flying saucer did come out of the water and had to cool itself off or something on the asphalt. Who knows? Or vice versa.
I have no idea. But I, you know, could you imagine though that you see you know, here's the thing, and especially in the 60s, it's not as bad now. Okay, I'm going to be honest with you. It's not as bad now as it was 20 years ago. If you sat there in front of a bunch of people and said, "Hey, I saw a UFO." You know, and if you're talking to like 10 people, like six of them are going to start wondering, okay, I wonder what's happened to this guy, you know, emotionally, you know, it's gotten more now where, you know, I think because of TV shows like Star Trek and all the other shows that have come and gone, you know, people now are conditioned. Yes. You know, we're not the only life out here. There's other creatures, other humanoids or whatever, there's other lives out there, not just ours.
Yeah, and anybody who studies astronomy or cosmology, you know, is following what's going on in physics, knows that it's almost impossible that we're the only intelligent civilization, just by this sheer size of the universe and the numbers of stars and numbers of planets now that we're finding, you know, there are more stars in the sky than there are grains of sand on the earth. Right. And now they're thinking that each of those may have at least four planets. Right. And one of those is likely to, you know, be within in some sort of range of the ability to evolve life. And, you know, we're also dealing with years, billions of years of celestial development. You know, there may be civilizations out there that have come and gone that are, you know, millions or billions of years old that have technologies that are beyond us. We all, I think, are have been conditioned, but also just, you know, the science has advanced enough for us to recognize this. So we're more open to that possibility, even people within the mainstream. I think astronomy has pushed this more than the UFO community has, you know, just by, you know, working out the Drake formula and discovering planets and putting things up like Hubble. It has led more people to agree that it's a possible thing and probably a very, very likely, almost improbable thing that there's not. Are they visiting here, though? That's a distinct possibility.
No, I think you know,
is
Michael.
Is it? Does it happen often? Are we like a zoo planet? You know, were we created by them or whatever? Are we observed? You know, all the conspiracy, you know, ancient alien type stuff. Maybe, but I think that if there are, you know, UFOs. They're either positioned here and observing us actively, or it's just a very, very rare circumstance from maybe a lot of different civilizations that are have keyed in on us, or, you know, maybe one civilization has keyed in and we're now in the network, you know, and maybe different civilizations visit us. That's totally possible, but we have no evidence, really.
Yeah, but, you know, I kind of look at things, okay, different. Now, I had a doctor on here a couple days ago. I'm not going to say his name because I disagreed with some of his philosophy. But I'm going to say this, okay? The Sphinx, and I say this quite often, the wear marks in the back of the Sphinx for years and years and years, they believe that was caused from the sand blowing on it. Then they recently, in the last couple of years, came to the conclusion, no, the Sphinx was under an ocean at one point. Now, a couple months ago, the Great Pyramid and all these other pyramids, they're saying they were also at one point under an ocean. So it kind of now makes you wonder, yeah, maybe the Egyptians used them to bury their, you know, whatever, their kings or whatever. But I think they might have already been there. And I got a funny feeling that we've been rebooted. Now, going back how maybe humans started on our planet is maybe going back so many years that our planet was rich in minerals, like gold and silver. Gold and silver is precious, not for just because it's worth money for a ring. It's precious in electronics. In fact, we're running out of silver. And there's more demand on silver right now for electronics than what there is able to be produced. That maybe we were visited by a race of humanoids back at one point. They brought their slaves. They harvest our planet for its minerals. And then when they decided, hey, they got everything that was feasible to get, they left. And maybe that's how the humans evolved on our planet. You know, there's a big jump in how, you know, if you look at how men formed from basically apes to, you know, going one step to the next step, there's a big, huge gap there. And I look at that maybe is a logical thing, because if you look at the Incas, you look at all these ancient tribes all through the world, one thing was precious: gold. Why would gold be precious to each one of them? Unless they knew something about the gold had a reason to be precious. I mean, otherwise brass could have been, pewter could have been, you know. I don't know. It's a lot of things, there's gaps in it. And now what we have going on, like we were talking about before we went on the air, there's a huge, since this last TV show came out, there's a big battle. It started this week among all the people in the community of UFOs. And it's gone crazy. Like I told you, I got so many emails and text messages today. I didn't even bother to respond because the people wanting me to choose sides. Well, I can't choose sides, but it's crazy. And then I'm getting people now, it just started this week, sending me pictures of things in the sky that they're seeing constantly, day after day after day, and it's gotten really bizarre this week.
Yeah. Well, are you wanting my opinion or to agree with you? Because I totally agree with you.
Well, I wanted your opinion, you know.
Yeah. Well, I mean, first off, the UFO world has always had its camps and its competing interests and its rivalries and egos and all that sort of stuff. And really, all paranormal, you know, sort of groups, or heck, even, you know, crocheting circles, you know, people, you know, you're dealing with people. So, you know, you're going to have battles. You know, it's called paradrama within all these different communities. And it's especially more so now with the internet, where it's easy to be passive aggressive and, you know, blog, and, you know, anybody can have a blog, including myself, you know, and interact with people that, you know, you're seeing on TV or seeing in, you know, on the news with a lot of these reports. You know, it's there's always been that sort of campish fighting going on. what's going on now is, I think the best way to sum it is, and I'm going to be totally neutral here, but I'll also give my, you know, my thoughts on, you know, what's going on with TSA and the Nimitz and whether or not it's good or bad. And this is just my opinion. What's going on is really within ufology, there are different ideas as to what the goal is. There are a lot of people that think that the goal is, you know, persuading the public and persuading the government to come clean because, you know, the reality of UFOs exists already. And, you know, they lean towards ET with this in a lot of respects. But, you know, the object is, you know, disclosure of what we already know. And then you have people within ufology that, you know, want to focus on the investigative aspect, and they want to, you know, have quality standards and promote science and all that. You also have other divergent camps of, you know, consciousness, and you have New Age type folks. And amidst all this, you have, you know, different social networks and business partnerings. You know, there's a lot of actual businesses and people competing for shows and speaker, you know, circuit gigs and television show gigs. And you're going to get different takes. A lot of, you know, a lot of opinion that is given now, you know, within the field is camp-based, you know, more than anything. So, you know, people align along different camps and, you know, just sort of have at it, you know, on social media. And it's really come to the forefront in the past few years with Tom DeLonge, you know, the rock star, being named UFO Researcher of the Year by the International UFO Congress. You know, that sort of set a lot of people off. You know, the people geared towards the science part of it, you know, that the battle was on between, you know, what is ufology? You know, is it public relations? And all your TV people will tell you it's public. It's about public relations. It's about persuasion.
It's about money, actually,
to do things, you know. So, you know, Tom DeLonge came forward and promoted what he knew through a business, through a company, you know, a profit-making entity, you know, basically a media company. And a lot of the UFO research groups now have sort of moved away from, you know, the science part of it, and, you know, they're mostly media companies now, you know. They're engaged in TV productions more so than, you know, conducting field studies or presenting papers to science academies or whatever. I think there's some people out there that are now starting to get back to that sort of notion that, you know, there's still a phenomena that needs to be studied.
And, well, you know, I'm going
to
jump.
But I think I was just going to say, I think that basically it comes down to, you know, there's those people that think that, you know, the purpose is to promote the subject to the world, you know, and convince the world of, you know, the validity of the subject. And I think there's also other people that think, no, we should be focused on the phenomena and not in persuading people or getting into the exopolitics stuff where you got government spies and TV networks and all the, you know, the media manipulation stuff of it. So,
yeah, but, you know,
is it good? Is it, I don't know.
Michael,
go ahead.
What's really bad, okay, and I've seen this like with, not Facebook, but I've seen it like with ghost hunting groups. Now, I had a ghost hunting group that came on my show, and I, you know, I was asking questions, and basically they never really went out on any ghost hunting to anybody's house to look for ghosts. It was a get-together for them, and their whole thing is, and I found this out talking to them the first 10 minutes on the show. I said, well, what have you done? Well, we went to the cemetery once. We're going to be going to a house and do a house cleansing here shortly. And I'm going, oh, wow. And what are you? We want to get on a cable channel.
Yeah.
And that was their first thing. Now, I've seen other groups, even in ufology, okay, They'll come on different, like Facebook Live. They claim they're experts. They're no experts.